Because I heard about what is going on with Stephen and Dwight, and I'm concerned. I'm not only concerned for them, I'm concerned for all of us, myself, and my children going forward, as probably most of you are. What is happening to this family, in my opinion, is an atrocity. They're being charged with a domestic terrorism charge that I think all of us can agree upon that lighting grass on fire doesn't make anybody a terrorist. Nobody's a terrorist for lighting grass on fire. So what we want to do tonight, this evening, I'm going to do my best to moderate. We were hoping to have some more people here to speak, but that's fine. We're gonna rock and roll this out. I'm going to run through some of the notes of what's happening with the Hammonds, how we got to this point, and then we'll do some questions and answers, and we'll do our best to answer those for you guys. We're also going to talk about what we can do to help this family. Some of the remedies that can be proposed and some ideas to throw around to you guys. So, first of all, is everybody fairly familiar with what happened? We know that there was a fire. We know the BLM wasn't happy about it. We know there's a court trial, so on and so forth. So, the court trial was held in Eugene by a jury that's what I consider not their peers. You people are their peers. Your peers in the jury are the people that you live around. The people that know you and can represent your character. So to have that jury trial not within your jurisdiction in your area is unjust in my eyes. As we go through this, there was no structures that were harmed. There was no property loss, and there was nobody was hurt. So how do we get to domestic terrorism? Anybody have an answer to that? Where does domestic terrorism come from? There is a fire that happened in 2013 on the Warm Springs area, and the same U.S. attorney prosecuted the lady that admittedly started the fire because she was bored and her firefighter friends were bored, and it burned 50,000 acres and cost the state $7 million to put out. She was sentenced not as a domestic terrorist, as an arsonist, and served 18 months in prison. So obviously we have a disparity in what's being enforced here. So back to the basics here. I'm going to run down my list here. Bear with me. The property wasn't lost. The Hammonds admitted to the burn. They were convicted on domestic terrorism. That law, we'll talk about that law here in a little bit. They served their sentence in full. The judge took and said the minimum sentence here is five years, and I can't understand in any way the crime. So he sentenced Dwight to 90 days, and he sentenced Stephen to a year and a day. They served that sentence in full, 100% in full. After they served their sentence, the federal government said, well, we don't feel that's enough. There's a minimum sentence. We want more. Took them back to court, appealed the case, and as we know why we're here today, they've been resentenced to serve the full 5 years in prison. From our understanding, January 4th is the day that they're supposed to report back to that. So that day's getting really close. There's a few people in here that spent some time talking to the Hammonds about it, and what we found and truly believe is that these people, they're terrified. Your neighbors are terrified of the government. They're terrified of what's being done to them. They're terrified of how it's being treated to them. Okay, they're worried about you, they're worried about their friends, they're worried about their family. I respect their decision to do whatever they're going to do, but in the light of things, their rights are being trampled upon. What's to stop the government from trampling upon your rights, or my rights? And who's going to stand up for those? Who's going to stand up and say, enough is enough? Enough is enough. The application of the statute is, like we talked about, is not correct. The domestic terrorism statute was created for a Timothy McVeigh type event when the Oklahoma City bombing took place. It was designated to convict people of, or I'm sorry, convict, charge people with damage to federal property as far as buildings and property goes. It was never intended for grass. It was never intended for our public lands to be damage and accuse somebody of domestic terrorism. So the misapplication of the statute falls upon the U.S. attorney. Now, when the judge sentenced the Hammonds to a year and a day and 90 days, respectively, and the government's not happy with that, is that the Hammonds' fault? Is that on the Hammonds? No, that's on the federal government. That's on the government and their judge system. So the definition of double jeopardy, I'm sure everybody is aware of what double jeopardy is, correct? I'm going to read it directly from the Fifth Amendment. And the definition of double jeopardy is, nor shall any person be subject for the same offense to be twice put into jeopardy of life and limb. It doesn't say twice convicted of the same crime. It doesn't say twice sentenced to the same crime. It says to put into jeopardy of life and limb twice for the same crime. They served their duty. They served their time. This is not only a violation of the Fifth Amendment, it's also a violation of the Eighth Amendment. And we'll go into that. I can tell you guys that they've been violated on six amendments. The First Amendment, the freedom of speech. They've been told to shut up. They've been told that if you don't stop talking to people about what's going on, if you don't stop talking to the likes of groups and people in this room, that we'll go ahead and we'll pick you up early and we'll send you to a prison that's less desirable. That's a threat. That is telling you to shut up. That is telling them to be quiet. Okay? The Second Amendment. They've been convicted as felons. They've lost their right to own a firearm over burning grass. Over burning grass. Okay? Their Fourth Amendment, the right to search and seizure, or to the right against illegal search and seizure. Their home was searched for a boot to match a print for a fire they admitted starting. Where's justice in this? Where's the line going to be drawn? So that's three. That's three rights right there. The Fifth Amendment, we talked about it. Double jeopardy. Not to be, you know, we can't be convicted of this. So the Sixth Amendment, the jury, like we talked about. The jury was not from the district of the crime that the alleged crime took place in. It's from people that don't know the Hammonds, the people that don't know their character. That is not the intent of the jury. That's not how the system was intended to run. Now, the Eighth Amendment, as the judge who originally convicted them said that he can't, in good faith, convict them of a five-year sentence because of the Eighth Amendment. What's the Eighth Amendment? Cruel and unusual punishment. Right? 5 years for burning grass is cruel and unusual punishment. So, moving on. Like we discussed, this is not about just the Hammonds. This is about our rights. This is about our rights and our government serving us, we the people, not ruling over us. They're not our rulers. They're not the king. We're not their subjects. They're there as a function of us to live happy, to live and pursue life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So as we talk further about this, our future generations' rights are at risk here as well, too. If they can trample on the Hammonds, they can trample on any of us, okay? So there's a very big difference, which is being put out there as what's legal and what's lawful. Ultimately, what's right and wrong? Is 5 years for burning grass right, or is it wrong? So as we move forward, I'd like to let Ammon Bundy come up here, and we'll talk about what some of these remedies are, what we can do to help this family, because I think ultimately that's what we're all here for, right? Everybody's wondering, what can we do to help this family? Another gentleman, Ryan Payne, is going to make a presentation on another subject that is very prudent to this matter. So as we move forward through this evening, you know, feel free, ask questions, make comments, address concerns, and we'll do our best to answer that for you. Now, we're just like you guys. You know, we're concerned citizens. We don't have all the answers. We don't have all the information, but we do the best that we can with the information provided to us, and we're willing to share that with you guys now so that you can do what you can do as a community to help this family and not only protect them, but also protect yourself at the same time. So, Ammon, do you want to come on up and see what you guys say?
All right.
hear me? So, again, I guess my name's Hammond Bundy. I don't live in Oregon. I grew up in Southern Nevada. Many of you probably know my family and what happened to us and the situation we were in. And it's very similar to the situation that the Hammonds are in. There are some differences because of the way we decided to fight it. But the issues were exactly the same. And I guess I ought to come clean with you. Actually, before I come clean with you, I would like to just recap on a few things, and then ask, and then give you opportunity to ask some questions. I had the opportunity to meet with the Hammonds pretty much daily for about 2 weeks before they were threatened, and then I don't blame them for shutting me out. They were afraid. They were threatened, and those threats, just specifically again to recap, came from the U.S. Attorney's Office through their through the Hammond's attorney, and the threats were specifically that if the Hammonds did not end their communications with me, that they would be detained early, and that they would be put in a less desirable for the Hammonds. Here the Hammonds are preparing to be going to prison for nearly 5 years. Right? And the U.S. Attorney's Office is threatening to shorten their time to prepare. Also, Dwight is 74, or very close to 74, and if he's put in a less desirable prison, what does that mean to him? That's basically like a death sentence to him. And so this threat was not just a light threat. Hey, you better stop speaking to them. This was that we were going to end your preparation early when you're leaving your ranch to your ranch hand and to your wives. And also, we'll put you in a prison where you won't come out of. And so the Hammonds backed away. And I don't blame them for doing that. But I wish they hadn't. It would have made it easier if they had not, but I don't blame them for doing that. A couple other things I wanted to just clarify as far as the case goes, and then I'll come as clean as I can with you. But that is, all of the allegations that were brought up to the sheriff about the fires were brought to the sheriff by federal employees. Every single one of them, okay? And the sheriff arrested the Hammonds and charged them with multiple state charges. The district attorney of this district, of this county, reviewed those charges and decided that there was not enough evidence to charge the Hammonds. There was not enough evidence to prove that the Hammonds were guilty of anything. So he dropped them. He dropped them, and he did nothing with them. He allowed them to expire, and that was his intent, to not prosecute them. 5 days before, the statute of limitation ended, the U.S. Attorney's Office brought up new charges, completely different charges than what the state charges were, and these charges were terrorist charges under the Anti-Terrorism Effective Death Penalty Act of 1996. And then we know the rest of the story from there. They were prosecuted. There was it started out that still to this day, one of our questions that we're asking in this notice of grievance, notice of redress grievance, is that there was never a grand jury that assembled and properly indicted the Hammonds. And the list goes on and on and on. Okay? But I kind of want to just open up a little bit, because we've been doing all the talking, to if anybody has any questions, and if I can answer them, or if anybody else in the room feels that they can answer them, then we'll answer them. We kind of get the elephants out of the room right now. And then I want to get on with some solutions to these things. So are there any questions or any thoughts? Yes.
Can you address the allegation, that the fire was started to destroy evidence of poaching?
I sure can. Well, what's the right way? Okay, I think Dwight would say it this way, and correct me if I'm wrong, but it was horseshit. There's no way a grass fire would burn up a full carcass. Okay? And the state fish and game went out there and scoured the whole area and found no bones, no carcass, no hide, nothing. It was thrown out as fast as it came in. But it was a tool to demonize the Hammond. That's what it was. Because a lot of us enjoy our hunting. And a lot of people enjoy and want to kind of protect that. You don't poach, right? That's kind of the general sentiment. And so they place that on them to demonize them. But there was nothing to even suggest that had any truth to it. Any other questions? Did I answer the question?
Just address the eyewitness that said it happened.
Oh, well, there was some hunters in the area, but no one ever saw it happen. They suggested that it happened. No one ever saw it happen. And just kind of give you an idea, here was. There was a fire going on, right? The hunters were leaving the area. There was firefighters everywhere, even helicopters. And you think the Hammonds are going to be down there shooting deer in the middle of this? The whole allegation is really ridiculous. So, thanks.
Okay.
Any others? Yes?
I'd like to make a comment if I could.
Sure.
My name is Tim Smith. I'm a consulting geologist, environmental consultant. My house will have a small ranch here, and maybe with the BLM. I think I'd like to talk about a couple of things that I think we probably need to be here for tonight. And the first one, obviously, is you talked on, and that's to show support for the Hammond family. I believe, and I've known the Hammonds for 30 years, the Hammonds want this effort to be constructed. They want it to be something that in this meeting and meetings and events that happen after this, they want it to be something that will be beneficial to not only them, but to the rest of us here in rural U.S. I think what they also would like, I believe what they also would like is for this event to shine a light on bringing awareness to the split between the people of rural America and the government. I think those two things are the first two things we should be here to address. And I know we all support the Hammonds. They're part of this community. We all have known them and loved them for a long time. The larger issue is what you were getting to, and I think what we need to do is send that message to the government that we, the people, have reached a point where we cannot be pushed further by agencies who represent themselves and a handful of eco-terrorists asking to penalize us using our own dollars to fund mismanagement of our lands and resources. It's been said by men a lot wiser than I that when the government fears the people, we have freedom, and when the people fear the government, we have tyranny. I'm afraid we are in a situation turning toward the latter of those two. What I'd like for us to take away from here today is some things to do, and you can talk about them later, but I think the most important one that will cover the larger issue is the Equal Access to Justice Act. BAJA, as it's known, as you probably know, is an issue or as an act that allows people to sue with very little accountability and use taxpayer-funded dollars to reimburse them if in the court's mind, they have rightful cause for action, even if they lose or win, either way. This has been taken out of balance. The people who use this are the people who basically do nothing to support and improve our society. Their argument is, well, is the Equal Access to Justice Act is open to anybody. But who of us, working people or people in the West, are going to use that act to go against people who do nothing to support our society? It's only those who are out there doing beneficial things, improving our economy, developing our resources, that are under attack and our dollars are used against us in that effort. Next thing I think what we have to do, and we have to demand accountability. We have to demand accountability from the agencies who carry out the agenda of the federal agencies. As you know, we have a serious lack of trust issue in the United States right now. We don't trust our government, and that's a sad thing to say. Classic examples of this are the IRS, basically taking away the First Amendment from groups who would oppose the administration of this country's agenda and program. We got the EPA, Bureau of Reclamation, Waters of the U.S. I don't know if you're aware of this. It's another issue that's coming forward. They have basically tried to force a new definition of Waters of the U.S. that will affect all of us. They have skirted the legislative process in that. They have flaunted the Constitution. They have avoided using the Constitution and abused the Constitution in trying to develop the federal control over the waters of the United States. Those waters are our waters, state waters, private waters. That's another way we have lost our trust. And we come here more locally and more currently, BLM and the U.S. Forest Service. They are managing our rangelands and forests for fire, not for fire and special interests for their agencies, so they can develop their budgets and continue to grow off of management of our public land for fire only. Multiple use has gone out the window. It's clear that the federal government cannot manage our public land properly. We have to get to the point where we are in charge of what happens in our local areas and with our land. This is a difficult thing to do because basically it's a federal process. And the federal government basically has to say, yes, you can do this. And we have to have enough gumption within our unity and unity within our counties to take on the federal government and say, we will take over control of these federal lands and use them for our best interest for all the people, not just a small minority of SWAYCHU and attorneys and eco-terrorist environmentalists. Finally, we cannot continue to fight these battles from behind. That's what we're here tonight. We're behind on this. As much as we would like to stand up and say we can go out there and we can help the hands now, what we are looking at is the process has happened. We can do what we can do politically. We can do. In support of whatever efforts they are making, but we have to be able to get ahead of these processes. What we have to do is we have to come together before there's a crisis. If we don't come together before there's a crisis, we end up with what he was talking about earlier, these gag orders, the fear that people are put under, the intimidation they're put under by the agencies. We have to be able to work in a free communication atmosphere, and that doesn't happen when you're under indictment or you've got the courts looking over your shoulder and the agencies looking over the court's shoulder and the political pressures coming down from above. So what we have to do is we have to get after these issues, these very specific acts and laws and regulations that are either unconstitutional or are improperly put into place. We have to get after those without the crisis behind it, because we cannot afford to jeopardize the life and livelihood and safety of any individual who gets caught in one of these crises. We have to get ahead of it somehow. We can't do this after the fact. We have to come together in groups like this, work hard, generate money, find lobbyists, find attorneys who can take these things to court and get a balance put back in the Equal Access to Justice Act, for one. And beyond that, we have to get ahead of it. I, for one, refuse to live in fear of the government anymore. And I hope that the government understands that they have to respect and listen to the people that they are supposed to serve. I hope those messages get out, and that's what I would like to see come out of this tonight. All of those things, and for this not to be a dead end here, for it to continue on, to continue on without putting the lives and risking the futures of any individual, to take this on in a time of non-crisis, which means going forward from here.
Thank you. I think that's a pretty good segue into what I have to say. I would like to give you a little bit of history about my family situation, because, again, as I said, my family was in the same situation as the Hammonds. However, at this point, my family moves about the country freely. We have, in almost 2 years, have not seen one federal vehicle on our ranch or even around our ranch. We have received no certified letters in the mail, or, you know, they want to threaten us from a distance, maybe from Washington, D.C., but there is no real imminent threat at all to us. And I'm proposing here, what we're proposing is that we do similar to what we did at the Bundy Ranch. And I want to go through that, because it wasn't just a bunch of people getting together. That's how it ended. That's not how it started. And I want to back up just a little bit so that you guys can draw these connections of what we did, and hopefully we can come up with a conclusion of what we need to do here. The same type of issue happened with us. They had a desire to take our ranch. There's been lots of speculation of why. The Hammonds also, it's very clear that they want to take their ranch, that is the reason why all of this is transpiring, because they want their ranch. They want their Steam Mountain properties. They also want their properties that are adjacent to the Malheur National Wildlife Refuge. At the Bundy Ranch, we had a situation where they used the desert tortoise as their excuse. They said that the desert tortoise is an endangered species, and that the cattle are putting them in danger, so therefore the cattle have to leave. My family has been ranching there since 1877. And the turtles and the cattle seem to be okay, but none of that mattered. We hired lawyers, we fought it, we had scientists, we did everything we could to try to prove, and it was proven time and time again in court. And we won time and time again on those, in the local courts, on those issues. The U.S. Prosecuting attorney stood on the steps of the courthouse building and says, well, for now that's what the ruling is. For now. Meaning he was just going to continue to exhaust these efforts, these court efforts, these legal efforts, until he won. That was what was his, say, he was saying on the courthouse. And so then in 1990, right around there, the BLM came up with a slogan, And the slogan they actually posted on their wall in the Las Vegas, the Southern Nevada district. And it said, no move by 92 and cattle free by 93. That was their slogan. And, you know, here we were supposed to try to have this culture of helping each other and so forth. And that's basically what their desire was. They began to either regulate the ranchers. There was 53 ranchers in Clark County. And we all ranched close together. We all shared public land. We all grazed and had our grazing rights there. And they began to, one by one, basically regulate. And they put regulations such as you had to remove the cattle at certain times of the year. You had to decrease your cattle count on the range. And the range down there is a lot different. Like, you don't pull your cattle off. You have to keep them on because you can't gather them. Anyway, there's a lot different condition. But these regulations were clearly in an effort to destroy the rancher's ability to make a living. And we tried to legally defend ourselves, and one by one, these ranchers were put out of business, either through duress or by actual force. And then ultimately, there was about seven or eight ranchers, besides my dad, there was about seven or eight ranchers that they finally went in and actually paid them $75,000 for their ranch, the price of a pickup. And the ranchers were so exhausted and so to the point where they couldn't stand anymore, they actually took $75,000 for their ranch. Right? And now those ranchers' children, every single one of them had to move to the cities. Right? And they don't even know where their meat comes from. Their grandchildren don't even know where meat comes from. And my dad, he began, him and a couple of the other ranchers and ranchers, they began to study what was their position. How could they fight this? And after an exhaustive amount of research and study and so forth, they found something that was even greater than what they ever imagined. And that was found in the Constitution of the United States, and the reason why we passed it out. Because they found that the federal government didn't have authority to be administrating the lands in the first place. That under Article 1, 8, 17, it says that in order for the federal government to own and control land inside a state, they first have to get consent from the state legislature. They second, they have to purchase it. And third, they can only use it for the erection of forts, magazines, dockyards, arsenals, and other needful buildings. Those are the rules that the federal government must follow in order to own and control land inside a state. So ask yourself, is the land that is being controlled in your county, have they got consent from the state legislatures to control it? Did they purchase it? And are they using it for the erection of forts, magazines, arsenals, dockyards, and other needful buildings? I'm not seeing any heads, are they? Did they purchase it? Did they get consent from the state legislatures? See, and that's what happened during, not to get too far out, but basically, at the moment of statehood, everything changes. No longer does the federal government have the authority to control and administer the land inside the state. It becomes the right of the people of that state to control and to administer those lands. And if the federal government needs some of that land to perform its duties, such as national defense, international trade, or be an appeals court for the states, if they need some of that land to do that, they have to get consent from the state legislature, they have to purchase it, and they can only use it for those reasons. That's it. And what it did is, what it does is it protects the people from what we're experiencing now. This issue with the Hammonds, this issue that you got, that all of us are experiencing, that you're experiencing in Harney County, it is a jurisdictional issue. The federal government has come down into our states and they are controlling the land and resources unlawfully. And that is the argument. There is no other argument. If we were abiding by the Constitution, the Hammonds would never have been, would never be in the position they're in. If we're abiding by the Constitution, these ranchers would be able to ranch without being in fear. If we're abiding by the Constitution, if one of us stepped out of line and broke a law, we would be prosecuted in a county court. And we would probably find justice there, actually. We would be tried among our peers here in the county. Right? So this is a jurisdictional issue. And if you try to argue anything else, even though the abuses are tremendous and they're grotesque, they're egregious, they are. But and we can't forget that they happen. Don't get me wrong. But the Hammonds should have never been in a federal court in the first place. And again, that is the foundational reason. Or principle here. That is the foundational argument. And it is the solution as well. The only solution that we have here, in my opinion, and in the many, many years that I've been involved in this, I've watched my dad and ranchers for my whole life. I'm 40 years old. My whole life, I watched my grandfather go through it. I watched my dad go through it. And it's all the same exact thing. I could give you statistics like there's over 100,000 cases where the federal government has used their courts to take land in the western United States. 100,000 cases. Guess how many of those the federal government lost? Zero. There is no justice found in the federal court system. If we think we can go run and prosecute the U.S. prosecutor in the federal court and win, we're fooling ourselves. So, I would like to. A lot of people have asked, well, why are you, if the federal government is doing this to us people here, then why are you being so hard on the county and the state? Why is this notice of grievance to the county and the state officials? You know, why are you basically insisting, and it's not just me, don't get me wrong, but why are you insisting that the state and the county hold an evidential hearing and come up with these findings? Why? What's that?
It's their jurisdiction.
It is their jurisdiction. It's their duty. Because we do not have a system of, we were never, there is no way for redress or protection of the federal government coming down against the people. There is no protection. Except what? When the states and the counties stand and say, no, not in our county. That is the protection. It's called federalism. Our founding fathers were federalists. You might think, well, man, I don't like the word fed in that word, right? Because I know I don't. But they were federalists. Yes?
How do you handle the argument of the supremacy clause being the federal government is over everything?
How does Dwight say it? Horseshit. Okay. I hope I'm okay with quoting about that. But it's for every you know, when we look at this and we go, okay, if we want to go to case law, you know, we can go back and we can give 100 cases where it proves that the state has authority to and it's sovereign, right? And we can go in the early. You know, in the last 75 years, we can go to another 50 cases where the Supreme Court was ruled against the state, okay? We can ask ourselves which was wrong and was wrong, which one was right. But it's right here, right? It's right here. It's very clear. The growth pattern of this country was that you had the states. They were sovereign, independent states, and they united together. The growth pattern is you have territories that were not states. That territory is under the jurisdiction of the federal government. And as Article 4 says, that they make all needful rules and regulations. Okay? But as soon as that territory gets populated enough to become a state, and as soon as they're enacted into the union as a state, no longer at that moment does the federal government have the right to exercise territorial law. No longer does it. That now that state is fully protected under the United States Constitution, and the people become sovereign and have their rights within the state. That's the growth pattern. And if we didn't have these, if we didn't have these, I guess wicked men, if you want to say, you call it what you want. But if we didn't have these wicked men, it's a beautiful pattern, because what can happen is our territories, we can obtain land, whether it was through a war or whether we purchased it, we can obtain land that could be a territory. The people can go in and begin to populate that territory, and it could become a state. We could do that across the whole continent, across the whole world, right? And make free people free across the whole world. That was the intent, right? But we have a situation where our federal government has turned their sights on the land and resources of the people, because that's where the wealth is generated, and the states have not done their duty to check and balance, and neither have the county. So that's why this problem is really a county's problem and a state problem, because the federal government is just doing what the founding fathers knew they were going to do. Yes?
Has anyone looked into the county or state being threatened by the feds, and that's why they won't step in?
Well, there's... Okay, that's a good question. Yes, they have. And remember, this is a problem across, you know, the whole country right now. And the main reason why counties won't stay, there's four reasons. One is there's either corruption, or the county officials are uneducated, they're ignorant, right? Or there's it's because of funding and fear. Those are the reasons why a county won't stand up. Because yes, they are threatened. There are times when they're threatened. They are funded, and they're afraid to lose that funding, and they're put in undue obedience. Thomas Jefferson said, if the states ever allowed the federal government to come in and control their land and resources, this is Thomas Jefferson said, if the states ever allowed the federal government to come in and control their land and resources, what it'll do is it'll destroy the economy of the state, expose the people to the tyranny of the federal government, and put the state into undue obedience. Because what'll happen is the state will not be able to generate enough revenue, and it'll have to beg for funding from the federal government. Right? And why is that? Because they control the land and the resources. All wealth is generated from the earth. Everything we see here, everything in front of us, came from the earth, right? And if you control the land and the resources, then you can control the people. You can control everything. And they understand this. And there's a lot of pieces to it. But I hope I answered your question. But it doesn't matter. It is the duty of the county. It is the duty of the state to stand and defend the people. And when they will not do it, then whose ultimate duty is it? It is the people's. It is ultimately our responsibility. We have delegated it to them. And if they will not do it, then we must. So, any other questions or thoughts or anything that anybody else wants to add before I go on? Yes?
I have two questions. First of all, a few minutes ago you referred to Article 1, Section 8. Okay, I haven't found the specific in there. I know it's supposed to be there.
Yeah.
The other is, what do you think of the federal government, said BLM, owning very small portions of land, such as around Steens Mountain or the Aquinnah Head, or, you know, parks? Do you think they should even own that?
It's not my opinion.
Oh.
The Constitution says direction of forts, magazines, arsenals, dockyards, and other needful buildings. It's not my idea. It's the Founding Fathers' idea that the federal government should not own land inside a state unless it's for those reasons, they have got consent from the state legislature, and they have purchased it. So, and the thing is this is one thing that we have to understand. That is the law. Right? So how many times have we been told we're breaking the law? We're not breaking the law. They're breaking the law. This is the supreme law of the land. And so, anyway, if you want to look at that, it's in clause 17. I can read it right here. I don't mind doing that. I've read it several times. Article 1, section 8, clause 17. And it doesn't number it in this book, so you have to kind of go down. It says, so first of all, it talks about their jurisdiction over Washington, D.C., and then it says, to exercise like authority, meaning like Washington, D.C., over places purchased by consent of the legislature of the state, in which the same shall be for the erection of forts, magazines, arsenals, dockyards, and other needful buildings. Okay? Now, to put things in perspective, when you step across, according to their view, and according to the territorial law that they are enforcing on federally controlled land, if you step across from private to federally controlled land, then you no longer are protected by the U.S. Constitution, according to them. You now fall under what is Article 4 jurisdiction, which is territorial law. And let me read you what that is. It's very simple. And this will start to explain a few things to you. It's in Article 4, Section 3, and it says, this is territorial law. So when you step over the line, you are no longer protected under the Constitution. This is the rule that you are that they say is their right. Congress shall have power to dispose of and make all needful rules and regulations respecting the territory. Okay? Am I making sense what I'm saying here? You do not have any rights on federally controlled land in a territory. You do not have any rights unless Congress deems that you have a right. Because we give them power to administer territories. Okay? But the thing that I'm trying to educate and trying to help understand is that we do not live in a territory. We live in the state of, or you live, most of you, in the state of Oregon. I live in the state of Idaho, right? And because we live in the state of Idaho, in our state of Oregon, we are protected, we have the right to protection under the full Constitution of the United States, meaning that we have due process, that we have the right to due process. We have the right to speak when we want to. We have the right to carry our guns and to protect ourselves. We have the right, and I could go on. But according to them, and you have to understand this, when you're on federal controlled land, they deem it as U.S. territory, and that they make all needful rules and regulations. They can give and they can take. Okay? And that's why we see these things happening. That's why all these regulations and all these rules, and they don't have to get legislation. That's why they can do all that they can do. That's what they believe. And it's our duty here as a people to understand that and to say, no, this is a state, and no longer will we allow you to control the land and resources within the state. And then it takes care of all of those water issues, EPA issues, all of those things. Because it takes care of all of that. And it puts the power back into the people's hands. And it creates freedom. And we saw that at the Bundy Ranch. We have that example that it can be done. Okay? Any other questions or thoughts right now? I know I'm kind of rambling a little bit.
I don't know if people here know, but the state of Utah has, they're in the process of demanding their land back as you're talking. And I think it was just yesterday that the state school board or the school authorities said that they were for that because the federal government loses money when they are in control of the land. If the state was in control of it, they would be earning $14 and something per acre. I guess I can't remember the exact figures, but look that up you probably know this.
Yeah, I'm very aware.
We need to do that in this state and in other states as well. So, take our land back.
Yeah, to get into it a little bit more, there is some conflict there. But that is happening in Utah, yes.
I'm new to the issue, so I'm learning a little bit more about it. Probably is a dumb question, but did Hammond violate Section 4 by crossing over into federal land?
The thing is, one, the land is not Article 4 land, okay?
Okay,
that's my argument. The land is what's called Article 1 land, meaning 1817. I mean, it's a state land, okay? But they did prosecute him as if it was Article 4 land. And yes, that's the thing is, yes, they violated it. You know, all of us every day violate it. I mean, there's not a person in here that probably doesn't violate one of those laws every day.
The Hammond property is surrounded by BLM property.
Oh.
Which are public lands. Is that an Article 4 thing there, or no?
I'm glad you're asking the question. Does anybody want to answer that in here? So he's saying, is the land that is adjacent to the Hammond's ranch, is it Article 4 land or is it not? That's what we're talking about, right?
Yes. Not if they haven't followed the steps that you laid out there. They didn't have the legislation approval or any of those things. They didn't purchase it, they know.
Yeah, it's inside the border of the state, right? Yes.
At what point did they actually cross that federal line?
Who?
The Hammonds.
They did.
We're not, they're saying what we're trying to say is there is no federal line. We are in the state of Oregon. Okay?
Could I make a stab that maybe they crossed that federal line when he's had a federal court?
So,
very good point.
Yeah, that's a good point. What happened there is they legitimized this unlawful act by entering into the court, by trying to argue this issue in the court. And that's what, unfortunately, the American Land Council is doing the same thing, so I disagree with their position because it's not constitutional. Although I'm glad they're bringing the issue up, but we cannot allow ourselves to get sucked up into a federal court and expect to win. It will not happen. We have to stand, just like my dad eventually did, because what happened in 1993, my dad said, once he understood, he tried to get the other ranchers to follow. I remember my dad nearly begging the ranchers to make this stand. But they wouldn't make it because they were afraid of their words. You know, I could almost remember them as a young boy. If we stand against the most powerful government ever known to man, we'll lose our ranches, we'll lose our heritage, we might even lose our lives. If we do this, we will lose. And my dad says, well, you have to, because it's the only way in which we have a stand. Okay? But they wouldn't. And so one by one, we watched them all be
lose.
Every single one of them. Until my dad was the last one. And you have to understand, the stand that my dad said was, no longer am I going to pay the federal government to use my own rights. Okay? And no longer am I going to sign the federal government's contracts to use my own rights. Okay? And he made that, and he stopped signing the grazing contracts in 1993. Now, and he would not enter their courts. He would not enter their courts. They didn't know what to do with them. They'd never had anybody not try to fight them in their own courts and waste $1 million. They didn't know what to do with them. So they ho-hummed around for a long, long time. This is in 93. And in 2006, the federal agents got all of the local law enforcement together, and they said, what we're going to try to do is we're going to try to designate Clive and Bundy as a domestic terrorist, and then we're going to try to charge him under domestic terrorist charges. Okay? That's what they said. But the thing is the good Lord was looking out for my dad that day, And my cousin, my first cousin, my dad's nephew, was in the room. He was a county deputy. He was in the room, and the federal government began to say all these horrible things to demonize my dad and why he's a domestic terrorist. And my cousin let him just do it. And they went on for about an hour. They had a PowerPoint presentation about how bad and wicked my father is, right? And then about to the end, when they basically announced that they were going to declare Cliven Bundy as a domestic terrorist and charge him as a terrorist, and then just basically throw him in prison and throw away the key, my cousin stood up and testified very clearly to everybody, which was about 100 people in the room, that his uncle, Cliven, was not a domestic terrorist. That he was a good man that loved his family, and all he wanted to do is to make a living the same way that his father, grandfather, and great-grandfather did. Right? And it ended it. It soured the whole meeting that they abandoned that idea at that time. Okay? And then they didn't know what to do. And then in 2012, they began to assemble, and they actually looked like they were going to do what they were going to do and what they did in 2014. But something happened. They actually came in to Bunkerville. They occupied a multi-level hotel in Mesquite, and then they left. They left. I mean, they just left. We don't know what happened. And then in 2014, they came in full force, 200 fully armed men, threatened my family that they would kill us. They actually used the words that if we resisted in any way, that that this would be another Waco or Ruby Ridge. Okay. My point is, I guess I'm kind of getting a little off point, because I wanted to bring back to the ranchers. Every one of the ranchers in Clark County lost their ranches. And their children, most of them had to move to the city, because they had to make a living. Their children and their grandchildren are now living in these cities and don't even know what it's like to be on the land. And my dad begged them to stand. Every single one of them that would not stand on the constitutional principles in which I'm speaking about today, every single one of them lost their ranch. And there was only one rancher standing. One rancher left. That was my dad. And that was because he stood on these principles. They are right, they are pure, and they are the way to make sure that we defend our life, liberty, and property. It is the right way. And so what I'm suggesting here is that we stand on the Constitution. We stand on jurisdiction. That they do not have authority to be administering the lands inside the state. Therefore, they need to leave the state and leave it to the people to do. And there's a lot to that. But really, it's really quite simple. And that's why we say, and we have said for many, many months now, that the Bundy Ranch is the freest place on earth. We truly, truly believe that. We are free to ranch. We are free to move about. We are a free people on that ranch. And that's because we stood on the correct principles, and the people came around us. They defended us, and we went to ranching, and that's what we're doing. And I'm pleading with you today to do the same thing. And got in bed one Monday night, and my phone chimed, these noisy phones, right? And I looked at it, and it was a little article that somebody sent me on the Hammonds. And there began to be this, like, almost overwhelming desire that I had. Like, it was unbelievable to find out what in the world was going on with the Hammond. I mean, and I couldn't sleep. I got up and I studied all through the night, every article I could. I read and read and studied about the Hammonds because I had this urge, this desire. And then after I felt like I had a pretty good idea of what was going on, that I began to get this urge that, that I needed to write something. Well, I'm not much of a writer, but I did the best I could. I was struggling, trying to write, right? And I asked the good Lord, I said, hey, if you want me to write something, then, I mean, I need some help. And he did. He gave that help to me, and I was able to write what I was supposed to write. And during that writing, I found something. I learned several things that were, that are very impactful here, and that is one. The Lord was not pleased with what was happening to the Hammonds. Okay? And I apologize for being emotional. I hope you guys can get past that. The Lord was not happy with what was going on at the Hammonds, and I understood that in this writing. Two, I understood that what was happening to them and what was happening to the people of Harney County was a type and a shadow of what was going to happen to all people across this country if we did not stand. That was the second thing I understood. And the third, I gotta think here a little bit, but the third piece was that this was very clear. The third piece was that if the people allowed these things to continue to the Hammonds, that he would hold them accountable. And then he shared with me something else that has actually came true. And I didn't understand it at the time. But he told me that I was supposed to go to the Hammonds. And I was supposed to find out some things. But he also helped me to understand. And I'm not saying that I'm getting a voice or anything. Don't get me wrong. It was an understanding. But he helped me understand that through this process, the Hammonds would eventually not allow you to help them anymore. Okay? And I found that out. I tell you those things because I want you to understand that I know without doubt that this is the issue, this is the time, and you are the people. And it is now that we must stand. And if we do, and we do it right, we do not have to do it with bloodshed. We do not have to do it with anything but honor. But if we do it right, we can restore the Constitution back to this county, and it can be an example for all the other counties across this nation. And I'm telling you, I know with everything that's inside of me that the time is now, this is the place, and you are the people. And I think I'll just leave at that. And I know there's a lot more work that we have to do. I do actually want to say one more thing. That part of this process that we did a notice of redress grievance, okay? And many of you may have read this. We sent it out across the country. We've been reaching quite a bit, actually, people all across the country, okay? And we asked them if they would sign it. If they would read it, understand it, and sign it. And I want to tell you that we have over 100,000 people that have signed. We are getting people every 3 minutes. Somebody is signing it. Every 3 minutes. That's approximately what is happening. The people of this country will come to you and help protect you. If you will make the right stand, they will come. They will be glad to come and be to your defense. You are not alone here. You are far from alone. I had to stop and just print it. I have 34 pages of people that have signed this thing. And it's every 3 minutes we're getting another signature. And that was 6 o'clock this morning. Okay? My point is, again, the time is now. This is the place. And I know you are the people. to do this. And it is the thing that we have to do is stand on jurisdiction and enforce the Constitution in this county. Remove the federal government from this county and begin to exercise our freedoms and rights here. And it's very simple. It's not as complicated as many may think. And I guess I ought to maybe end with some questions or maybe some comments. But that's where I'm at. That's where I'm at. That's where this is at. Do we have any questions?
Well, goddamn BLM, the government runs it, but today they need to one's going to pay attention. If I've got a lot of years behind me and I've seen a lot of fires, and it's probably the last 15 years since really. It used to be everybody went to fire or whatever and they had to stake and you worked, you put it out. And you didn't get up at 8 o'clock in the morning and quit at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. You used to take, this last summer, they come out of Burns here and would come out to Crane and they wouldn't get out there till 8 o'clock before four of them pickups and them all around there. And then about 10, 11 o'clock, you'd see it headed out where the fire was. Well, do in, do down, the fire was just... So, and they talked about, well, you had to have experience, you had to have to educate. That fellow that sent them kids into that fire in Colorado, they made a hero out of him. And it was rough. I mean, if anybody's ever been out, I rode every damn day in the mountains with the wind. And you'd be right here, the wind would be blowing this way. You just go around a little bit like this, the sun's going to be blowing the other way. So he didn't know, well, he had the expertise. Now they make a hero out of him. So I
we have a lot of complaints, right? We have a lot of those.
And it's never, and New York and all that, the EPA and all that stuff, cut that, and they don't have anybody in our government, elected in there, that's got guts enough to stand up to anybody.
It's up to the people. And it's up to the people of Harney County.
The little county around here and the city or whatever, they get these grants to get all of that. If they do too much, that's all going to be cut off. And that's where they got us. And I hate to say, but they're going to, it's too late, guys.
So, no, it's not. Let me give you some facts of Harney County. And I don't want to be the expert of Harney County, so you guys could say whatever. But let me just give you a couple facts. Did you know that in the 80s, Harney County was the most wealthy county in the state of Oregon? That the income was the highest income of the entire state, the family income. And now, guess what it is? It's the lowest. Okay? The population has declined. And the primary industrial employment was forestry. The second was ranching. Those were the two economies. Why do you think when you look at the Harney County logo, it has a cow and it has trees? That's what this county was built to do. And it's very simple. We get back to work. We get back to ranching. And we ask the people of across the United States to assist us in protecting us how we do it. And that's what we do. And immediately what you see is a restoration of the economics here in this county. And people will begin to thrive again. No longer do your children have to leave the valley to go to the city. Now they can actually make a living here. They actually stay here. They can actually have a future here. And that's what this is about. It's very simple. Restore those things back to Harney County by removing the federal government and going to work. Well, it depends on if you're committed enough. And Ryan, are you ready? Because Ryan here, I want to, I guess this is Ryan Payne. He represents and many 1,000 people across the United States. And I want to read something to you in the Second Amendment. I want to read the whole Second Amendment to you. Can you go there? It's on page 21. Because you just asked the question, how do we do it? Okay? Second Amendment. It says, a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state. Can I read it again? A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state. Can I read it again? A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state. That's how. And that's why I'm alive. Because if the militia did not come to our defense, I would not be here today. My family would have been murdered. They told us that they were going to murder us. And until the militia came and put a check and balance on them, they were going to murder us. And as soon as the militia came, all of a sudden, now they ship-shaped up and left the area. And this can be done without bloodshed. We do not have to believe that just because we pull the militia in, that all of a sudden we have to have a gunfight. That's not what we're proposing here. We're proposing that the people go about their business according to the Constitution, and the militia protects them while they do that. That's what we're proposing here. And with that, I'm going to turn the time over to Ryan.
When the course of human events becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and their happiness. Prudence indeed will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes. And accordingly, all experience has shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer, while evils are sufferable, than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same object, evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty, to throw off such government, and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferance of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former systems of government. I'm sure you all know that's the Declaration of Independence. There are three foundational documents which formed the principles by which our union exists. They're the Holy Bible, God's Word, the Declaration of Independence, and the Constitution. And the Declaration of Independence we celebrate every 4th of July. And we've all heard it. We know it. It's
It's what gave us the country that we have now. So very briefly, I want to introduce myself. My name is Ryan Payne. I'm an electrician in Montana. A little bit about my background, very, very briefly. It's not about me, but it gives you an insight as to why I'm here. I'm a soldier. And when I was 17, I took an oath to uphold and defend the Constitution of the United States of America from all enemies, foreign and domestic. The government, which we believe is here formed by our Constitution, and upholding the will of the people, has sent me all over the world to uphold this oath. What I have found upon returning from that service is that the issue of upholding and defending the Constitution from all enemies, foreign and domestic, is much more pertinent domestically than it is from foreign invasion. And so, in the interest of upholding that oath, I have, along with many others who have taken this same oath, started to network with one another and become familiar with one another so that we can most effectively uphold this oath for the people. So that's basically what I want you to understand. I have dedicated my life to be a servant of the people in defense of them, in defense of their constitution, and in defense of the principles of freedom and liberty by which we live. So what I'm going to do here tonight is I'm going to present you with the process that the founders used after that declaration, before and after that declaration were signed, in order to alter or abolish the government, which was showing itself to be tyrannical to the people. Okay. And what I want to include in that is that as a servant of the people, and as a soldier, and as militia, it is our duty to, as servants, then, to particularly serve the people, which means that the people are the masters. The people formed the government only by the people's will can we institute these structures to govern us all. And so, with that, I want to really quickly read the 9th and 10th Amendments so that you understand that the founders solidified these notions to us and that the people are the ultimate authority within our founding document. Amendment number 9. The enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people. Shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people. Amendment number 10. The powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively, or the people. Or the people. Okay. So, this is the first time that I've given this presentation that I'm about to give you, and it's in the form of a PowerPoint, so I'm going to be reading it as notes. Bear with me. I apologize if it seems a little dry. Men that signed the Declaration of Independence. 56 men signed the Declaration. And who were they? It was called the Second Continental Congress, but what was that? The constitutional government wouldn't be formed for another 15 years after that declaration was signed and acted upon. So where did these guys come from, the founders? They came from amongst the people. They were very well respected in their communities. They were active participants in the governmental structures that the people had formed in order to see to their security and happiness. And they were wise men that were drawn and elected from amongst the people in order to pursue those ends specifically. And there's a manner in which they did this, the people did this themselves, which was, aside from the British government, which was being oppressive to the colonies. Because once that government becomes oppressive, there is no correcting it. Sam Adams says that a constitution, excuse me, it was John Adams, the second president of the United States, said, a constitution of government once changed from freedom can never be returned. Can never be returned. So how do you go about correcting the corruption of the processes that your government has taken? Well, they gave us an example. And you've probably never heard this example before. If you have, then you've done quite a bit of research, because it takes a lot of digging to arrive at what they did. We know we celebrate the Declaration of Independence every 4th of July. We know that there was a bunch of founders, and they were good men, good honest men. But you're not going to learn this in school. And unless you do the research, you do a lot of due diligence, you're not ever going to hear this, especially from the government. This is not knowledge they want you to have. So, it's called committees of safety. And they began in the colonies in the 1600s, starting with Jamestown. We know that was basically the first colonial settlement. And the people formed these committees as they came together in mutual interest for each other's safety. And by relying on one another, we ensure our own safety and the safety for our families. And from those committees of safety, greater governmental structures can be formed. Okay, so all a committee of safety is an executive. And now we get into some of the particulars. What were they? They were governments established in the absence of the ability of the existing government to provide for the needs of a civilized society. So what they were was civil bodies politic. On the voyage from England to America, the Pilgrims, with the Mayflower Compact, created a civil body politic. Jamestown also had a civil body politic. Over the years, they were known by various names. Committee of Protection, Committee of Correspondence, Committees of Safety, associations for or of a particular area. Their purpose was always to provide for the needs of civil society, a civil government. Committees of Safety existed prior to 1689 and were called by various names. The committee, which was created in that year, 1689, in Boston, New York, is significant that it was created by the members of the militia. The colonists were dissatisfied with the government of the crown, headed by Governor Sir Edmund Andros. Recognizing that the military, the militia, authority, must always be subordinate to the civilian authority, and having serious concern over the abuse of authority imposed by Andros, the militia of Boston created their own civil authority in the form of the Committee of Safety. Representation on the committee was based upon two delegates being selected by the citizenry to represent each community. And the delegates gathered and exercised their authority by eventually, imprisoning Governor Andros for a period of 1 year. In 1774, 2 years before the Declaration of Independence, the various committees of safety called for the First Continental Congress. Delegates to that Congress went from town to town, to county, to provincial level committees before being selected to go to Philadelphia. In Western Massachusetts, committees of safety sent armed militia to force the resignation of judges appointed under the Massachusetts Government Act of 1774. So, committees of safety sent the armed militia to force that resignation. Some committees, such as Worcester County, declared independence from British rule. Unless Massachusetts government was returned under the original charter of 1774. Now, something to understand here is that there was a British constitution at this time, and that constitution itself was being violated by the British government. And so the people were asking for that their actual constitution to be reinstated. Here's a quote. Real quick for you. Cambridge, April 29, 1775. This may certify that the bearer, Mr. Paul Revere, is messenger to the Committee of Safety. I need that back. There we go. Is messenger to the Committee of Safety, and that all dispatch and assistance be given him in instances that the business of the colony may be facilitated. Joseph Warren, Chairperson. What's the purpose of the committee? Representation, unity, organize and call up militia, correspondence with other committees, coordination. What if we had a natural or man-made disaster that disabled local government and emergency services? What if our county or city disbands the police department, like other cities are doing in the United States? For example, Clarkston, Michigan, Pontiac, Michigan, Aztec, New Mexico, and many more. You probably aren't even aware of this. We need to form and actively create a civil body politic regarding communications, food storage, water storage, command structure, so that if the time ever arises where the committee needs to take the reins to protect the community, the plans, means, and manpower will already be prepared to do so. So, what's the goal of joining a committee of safety or creating one? For your own safety. If you had a flood, hurricane, tornado, or other natural disaster, would you want to wait for FEMA? If crimes were to become rampant in your community, would you want to rely solely on the police? If food shortages occurred, would you have the shared production and storage of food? If power outages occurred, would you have a shared source for food preservation and water wells? If a foreign country or the UN were to invade the United States, would you wait for the military to help? Cultural challenges. The time to reinstitute neighborhood committees of safety and to address issues when existing government ignores them or fails to address them properly is now, as Hammond stated. As a result of the devolving social, political, and economic conditions, renewed interest in the committee of safety concept is spreading across the Union. So this idea is getting out there. Those actively elevating the concept into action are facing a serious challenge. At the most basic level of community life, the neighborhood, there exists a culturally institutionalized level of interaction among modern American neighbors that is arguably the lowest of any in American history. The challenge is even greater because the Great Depression was so long ago, and we haven't seen war on American soil since 1865. We're very insulated from the effects of not vying for our own safety. It is therefore nearly impossible for most Americans to visualize what life would be like if we were under attack in our homes, or if store shelves were empty. Most businesses were closed, and there was no electricity, unless you just close your eyes and think about it. And so I'd like everybody to close their eyes for just a second and imagine what it would be like if you don't create structures for your own safety. What would it be like if you lost all those things? What would it be like if a natural disaster occurred and we didn't have structures in place which would take care of the necessities for us? If we didn't come together and support one another and decide that it is important for my survival that I seek means to help you with yours. Or what if a foreign government invaded our homeland? The military is on the military bases. The military right now, to be quite honest with you, is spread out all over the world, pursuing tyrannical endeavors. With your tax dollars, we were, for quite some time, the only country in the entire world that was invading other countries. The purveyors of liberty and freedom. The only country in the entire world invading other countries.
Okay. To interrupt this.
Yes, sir.
As time went on, there was the militia, there was... So we evolved. Did it evolve into a federal armory in each locale that proposed to take care of things like that? National Guard, for example, would be... Is that what it was meant to do? And it just...
Is that what the militia was meant to do?
Is that how it evolved?
How the militia evolved?
Right.
The militia, the word militia comes from the Greek word militai. So it's a very old concept. The notion of the Spartans is probably the one that will hit home the easiest. The word militai means the civilian, the citizen, in his capacity to protect his community. So the militia is you and me and all of us. And it's us with our abilities and in our capacity to protect ourselves.
My point is we've been lulled into complacency.
Right.
Yeah. And how did we get there, I guess is my question.
How did we arrive at there, at that point? We have, there's desires that people have in our communities, and we want to, as we move on through life, we want to raise our families, and we want to do our jobs, and we want to live a happy life. That's why the pursuit of happiness is enshrined in that Declaration of Independence as one of the foundations. And in pursuit of those things, we lose sight sometimes in trying to satisfy ourselves of the importance of coming together in order to pursue our happiness. And so when we get wrapped up in our own individual pursuits, we begin to ignore each other. And so that was one of the cultural challenges that was addressed there, is that as a people right now, we are more disconnected than we have ever been. We are relying on interactions through social media and electronic means, especially the younger generation, my generation. And we're not communicating with our neighbor anymore. We're not talking to each other. We're not addressing each other directly. So that's essentially the issue.
We're not concerned with each other's issues. We're down here at the last wire, and we're suddenly worried about the Hammonds. We should have been worried about the Hammonds 5 years ago.
The Hammonds is, they're a scope into a greater picture. The issue that is affecting the Hammonds is actually affecting every single person in this room, but unless you come together and we start addressing these issues, unless you're talking about them with each other, unless you're discussing the means of how to remedy these situations, then you're barely aware of it, and you're pursuing your everyday life. And the time is now to see the Hammonds and glimpse at their situation, and then ask yourselves, if you conduct yourself in the interest of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, if you conduct all of your affairs in those, along the lines of those three things, like the Hammonds have, then how far down the road is it before what is happening to the Hammonds is happening to every single one of us? Ultimately, what we do know is that the path that our country appears to be on, every single time throughout history, when the people do not stand up for themselves, do not utilize their God-given right to self-protection and self-governance, it ends in tyranny and genocide. Genocide. This isn't fear-mongering. This is how it ends up. Every single time. It's not a question. Did I answer your question, sir?
Just to bring it forward.
So the militia is the people. And this is, that'll answer the rest of your question, I think. The militia is the people. And so that's why the Second Amendment says, it says, a well-regulated militia is necessary to the security of a free state. And so the right of the people to bear arms shall not be infringed, because the militia is the people. And United States Code, Article 10, also outlines who the militia is, although it's been remanufactured in certain ways. But it says that the unorganized militia is the people from 16 to 45. They call that the militia of the United States. So the United States government can call up anybody in the entire country across the Union from the ages of 16 to 45 to serve in defense of the Union. Each state also has its own requirements for militia service. Yes, sir.
Great job. But, we are, what are we at, almost 2 hours into this meeting?
I'd like to make some call to action, if you can get your message.
It's, I have quite a bit more, but I think if you feel that the necessary information is provided, then feel
well,
free.
Well, so you asked the question, well, what do we do, right? And we have, across the United States, a people that will stand with you. I've already explained that, and I'm confident in that, okay? But the thing is it's not necessarily right for us or for the people to come in here and to make a stand without the people forming and being in control of it. That's what this Committee of Safety is where the people elect this committee, and this committee is in charge of those that will come in and assist across this country in defending the rights of this people and in enforcing the Constitution. And I'm not going to dance around what we're talking about here. We're talking about removing these unconstitutional agencies from Harney County and freeing the people back up to go ranching, logging, or whatever else. But the people have to, you have to exhibit enough organization to form these committees of safety so that you can charge and be in charge of the militia. That's what it comes down to. That is the proper way in which this is supposed to happen. And Ryan has explained this, and I kind of interrupted him because I'm worried about time. But that's what it is. So, did you have a comment?
Yeah. My name is Jason Patrick. I'm actually from Georgia. And the reason I want to stand up and tell you, he's right. I'm from Georgia. I know these two men because they did exactly what he said. I was working on a roof. I'm actually part of a militia. We train. We do that type of stuff. And somebody said, hey, have you seen what's happening with the Bundys? No, I haven't. Send me a link. I'm on a roof, looking at my phone, call my group. Hey, I need you to pull everything you can about this deal in Nevada, Bundy Ranch. I'll be there at 5. And I was working, I'm still reading, and I'm making a couple of phone calls. And I get over to his house, and we packed our gear less than 24 hours later from that call. Packed our gear, drove 48 hours to Nevada, didn't know what we were getting into because there was all kind of scare tactics. Oh, this was going to happen. And when I got there in the middle of the night, 1 o'clock in the morning, Friday before the stand-up. And when I got there, I looked around and went, wow, we win. He says, what? We win. There's over 300 people here camping in the desert. That's enough. That's all it takes. And it's not violent. What he's talking about is he's written the grievances, and you basically, I've told a bunch of militia guys since then, because I got a little bit of a following from having done that, and I've been in a few other places, and I says, all you really do is say, no thank you. Huh? You know, me, him, and whoever you empower, you say, hey, we don't want this anymore. We want freedom in Harney County. We want our stuff back. We don't want, we, meaning you, We don't want the Hammonds to go to jail for terrorism. The Hammonds can't stand up and say, we don't want to go to jail for terrorism, and we want you to stand with us, because they're afraid. They're afraid. And the militia can't come to their aid unless they ask for help. So I got militia all over. What are we going to do? What are they going to do? There's not a lot we can do because they haven't asked for help. But the county can ask for help. You guys can say, form a committee of safety and say, you know what? We don't want our neighbor to go to federal prison for terrorism for burning grass. And we need help. And you know what happens? These gentlemen and myself and a massive network that you don't know exists probably goes, we're coming. As soon as you say, my county, we form a committee of safety here. I'm pleading with you formally. And write some restitution that says, we, the people of Harney County, do not want the Hammonds to go to federal prison for burning grass. And you will see more assistance in this county than you've ever seen in your life. And we will say, no, they're not going to prison. The people, we the people, aren't going to allow them to go to prison. It's not violent. It's basically like, hey, excuse me, no thank you. No thank you. There's no terrorism here. We all live with these people. They're not terrorists. They're ranchers, just like some other ranchers I know. They have rights just like I do, and you're not going to trample theirs just like you're not going to trample mine. And I want to tell you from my own heart, okay, regardless of the militia, I learned about this Hammond thing a while back, and I will go camp on their driveway by myself and tell the government, you can come get them. You can, and I'll do it unarmed. You can come get them right over my dead body. Right over my dead body. You cannot come in here, no thank you. You can come get them. All you have to do right now, if you want them, is to shoot me right here. Because if they don't have rights, I don't have rights. If they don't have rights, you don't have rights. And America knows it. A signature every 3 minutes. America's primed. They're ready. And if you can do what he's talking about, I am not from here, but I am from here. I'm an American. This is America. Let's act like it. And I don't know how else to put it. That's where I met Hammond. I met him that night. And he's my brother. He's me. He has rights. You have rights. We have rights. Let's protect him. I will. I don't care what it costs. I'll do it.
So, and then, do we have any other thoughts, comments, questions? Let's get them out. Yes.
Just one more. Between you talk about a militia, and they can help the federal government if they need it, but also, the 29th Federalist paper states that the militia can be used as it was starting to happen in the protect us from the tyrannical.
That's the reason why it was developed.
That's a good backup to the Second Amendment.
Yeah.
And I think the 45th and 46th are also.
It's not necessarily a backup. It is one of its intended purposes.
Okay. And to defend also, the I'll people. Mention to you that in Linn County, where I came from today, we've been getting together and trying and doing some of the citizen, getting our food, our medicine, and other survivables together from the starting place. So it can be, it's starting at some place. So.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. How many people does it take to start a safety committee?
It takes a body here, just like what we have here.
Let's form one.
Well, I would like to propose it.
Is that the next step?
I would like to propose whether the people want to form one or not, and if they do, then we can move forward. It's up to you. I'm not at this point. We can help and assist, but it is up to the people to form a committee. And but great question. Is there any other thoughts? Any other I mean, yes, sir. let's get the elephants out of the room. I mean, let's get the fear or the thought of that we're doing something wrong or whatever. Let's get it out, because these things need to be talked about. We need to make some action. Yes.
With your letter that you have here, you wrote this, and then if I understand right, there's a second letter to come.
That's correct.
Can you tell us the process between here and there, and where we go from there with these 30 things?
So this was a notice redress of grievance. Right? And what this is we are basically insisting that the county government and the state government, what we're doing is we listed all of the evidence of things that we have found that are wrong with the Hammond case. I mean, I could go through them from the very beginning. Jurisdiction, they were not indicted properly. The family was, or the government, clearly situated the Hammonds in duress in an effort to take their property. And so on and so forth. There's a list, right? And we've insisted that the county government assemble a evidential hearing board, right? That they assemble an evidential hearing board of the people, and they look at all this evidence and expose the truth, basically, is what we're looking for. And we give them 5 days to respond back to us. And tomorrow is the fifth day, and we have heard nothing from anybody. I have reached out to them.
Tell us again who you sent this to.
We sent this to Sheriff David Ward, Commissioner Dan Nichols, Commissioner Pete Runnels, Justice of the Peace Donna Thompson, District Attorney Tim Callahan, Attorney General Ellen Rosenblum, Governor Kate Brown.
And none of them are here tonight.
None of them are here tonight. They were all personally invited to be here tonight. Okay?
I have a question.
Yeah.
You left off, and my husband, I'm from Grant County, which is a neighboring county, but my husband asked me to ask you, why did you leave Judge Grasty off of it? Did you think he was because he's the head of the county court. In the Oregon system?
Well, that's a good question, and I would say other than understanding whose duty this was, see, as a judge, he's supposed to be a neutral party in administrating the due process.
Actually, in Oregon, the county judge is actually, and he does have a few judicial duties that he's just recently, in the last few years, gotten. But he is the head of the county court. They just
You have to understand, though, that the purpose of a court is not to get politically involved in any party. There's supposed to be a neutral party that administrates the proceedings neutrally. He's not supposed to be politically involved and make political decisions and so forth. So anyway, that overall was the reason why. But really, there's only three people that really matter on this, and that is the sheriff and the two commissioners.
But Grasty is a commissioner as well.
Maybe I didn't understand that, which is very interesting. He's a commissioner and a judge, which seems...
Yeah, they call him a judge, but he's actually the head commissioner.
Okay.
And that's how it is.
Well, then maybe you should have got one, but there's sort of some conflicts there in the proper form of government, just so you know. You should never have a judge that's also a commissioner. Never. That should never happen. So anyway, maybe I don't understand, but that's fine. But either way, these were the people. I think the point that you wanted to bring out is, what are we doing? This was
from here to the next piece of paper.
This was an effort to get the county to do their duty, which is to find out what's wrong and to ultimately expose these corruptions, and then create a resolution that the sheriff and the commissioners can enforce inside the county. But it appears at this point that they are once again ignoring these things. And just so you understand, there are more people represented in the state of Oregon than any other state. However, I also want to understand that every state in the union, there are people from every state in the union that have signed this thing, including Alaska and Hawaii. Okay? Now, if they ignore this, our intention was to do a notice of demand, which is listing all the petitions that have been ignored, which is great at this point. We have petitioned after petition. The Hammonds have exhausted almost $1 million in their legal defense, and the list goes on, right? To list those and then demand that the Hammonds' rights be restored. But we also, honestly, might believe that it'll probably ignore it. Okay? And then at that point, the people have done everything. We've also petitioned Ellen Rosenblum directly. She has chosen to ignore. We have spent, the Farm Bureau collected over 8,000 petitions that have been pretty much ignored, well, completely ignored. We have, the sheriff has received over 3,000 emails from in the, and out of the state, and he has ignored them, just gives lip service. And the our elected representatives, the state senators and the state, or your, I should say, your state elector, state legislatures have also received thousands of emails. And those emails, all they were asking to do is to go find out about the Hammonds, and if you feel that the Hammonds were not dealt with correctly, to make a stand politically, do anything, nothing. They didn't even come to Harney County. Nothing. They completely ignored. And so my point is all of the prudent methods that are being put forth are being ignored. And so it is time to form a committee of safety, because our current government is not even attempting to do its job. And to form a committee of safety here amongst the people and begin to enforce the Constitution. And that's what we're calling for.
A committee of safety in Harney County presumably would have to consist of citizens of Harney County, is that correct?
Yeah, it's a representative form of government.
Absolutely.
So it's Republican in nature, meaning that the people who have a concern for their safety and the safety of their neighbor would then draw from amongst themselves the most trusted individuals in your community and elect them to represent them. And so the Committee of Safety then becomes a civil body politic formed directly from the people. In the same manner that you elect county commissioners and the sheriff, you elect members to the Committee of Safety. So it is an executive branch for
a lot of people here that are not from Harney County, including myself. And but this committee that we're forming here would be of residents of the county.
Correct.
Yeah, so if there's a handful of people that are not from Harney County here.
Do a show of hands of the people that are.
Everyone from Harney County, please raise your hands. 80%. Some of the people, folks, are from surrounding counties. But if you don't mind me asking, where are you folks from that didn't raise your hand?
Mountain County.
Which is in Oregon, right?
Yeah.
Next door.
It's the next county that the government's going to take.
Yeah.
So, I disagree, sir.
They're going after the major counties.
They're going after.
It doesn't have to be county specific. You don't have to be county specific.
That's our choice, and that's their choice.
Yeah.
And this is the beginning of a process by which we can halt the flow of tyranny.
So I'm just going to lay it on the line. Who here as a vote would like to form a committee of safety? All those four, raise your hand.
Help form one in any county.
Great.
Hey, will you keep your hands raised so I can count them? Okay. All those against, please raise their hand.
Just got your vote.
Who hasn't decided yet?
You haven't decided.
Who hasn't decided yet?
Just as important, how many people are from Harney County will support these folks?
Heck yeah! Woo!
do we need to, well, Ron, you know this process better than me.
Yeah, and a lot of this, there is a process that can be pursued. It has been pursued by the founders, so obviously there's a well-established process for this. But quite honestly, its basis is outlined as three parts of government, this representing the executive. So the idea would be then to nominate people from amongst yourselves who you think are the most qualified. It is an executive, so executive experience is probably pretty important. A knowledge of the Constitution is very important, and a trust from the people that you have their best interests in mind, is very important. And one thing to understand is that as specifically being the people, it's people like myself who have taken an oath to uphold and defend the Constitution and its people that are looking for our masters. When the government is no longer abiding by the Constitution, we don't have anybody to answer to, and we're here to defend you. So that's what this does. Anyway, you can put names for it, I would say, would be the next step.
So who would like to not, or we're looking for nominations of who, is it a chair, committee chair?
You'd be 3 to 5. It can be as low as 3 people, because that presents a quorum that can be broken by one of the, arguments can be broken by one individual, or 5. It is a pretty good number, because you put together 5 people representing the people and their will, and they can probably pretty firmly make decisions. So nominating 5 individuals, and then that committee itself, those 5 individuals become the Committee of Safety, and then they decide on the administrative process that pursues. Yes, sir?
To pick those 5 individuals, does this need to go before the county at large, or is this something we decided at this meeting, as this was an advertised public meeting?
What it can do is, yes, this was an advertised public meeting, so as far as it goes concerning this issue, you are the county. And what can be done, stated, then, and you decide on people who you'd like to elect to those positions on that committee, then you can put out a public announcement, and should, with prudence, put out a public announcement that the committee has been formed, and that if there is an issue with the individuals on that Committee of Safety, then a revoke can be taken, or they can bring up those grievances.
Let me write them down.
Hammond, why don't we do this? Why don't we turn the heat back on so everybody can warm up?
Okay.
These guys talk amongst each other so you're not put on the spot. Get a cup of coffee, let you guys talk, and then we'll ask a question again.
Is it agreeable, and how long do you guys need? Somebody give me a time that you want to reconvene.
It's like the worst time of the year.
Is it ever?
Right.
Everybody has plans. It's fun to do. I'd like to do some more research personally, because I have to believe what I have to see.
Right, absolutely.
So the vote, are we changing our vote then? Because the vote that I'm fine with that. I'm just proposing. There was a 80% vote that we form a committee, and there was no opposition to that vote.
Mr. Chairman, I nominate Kevin Johnson.
Kevin Johnson? Is he here? Is Kevin Johnson here? Kevin Johnson raised his hand.
He's on the phone with the glasses.
He's the guy with all the questions.
I nominate Chris Briles.
Chris who?
Briles.
How do you spell the last name?
B-R-I-E-L-S.
Mm-hmm. Did you see that?
B-L-S?
The crazy guy. Is that guy that reads out there in his watch? He's using a neck brace. Is there a mechanic in one of his?
50 mile an hour.
Remember, these are nominations. We're going to vote on them, so you don't have to.
We got like 10, 12 inches of snow.
Rick, who? Kevin Johnson, Chris, Ryle, Rick, Abine.
I'd like to nominate Kim Smith. Kim Smith.
Kim? Kim?
Kim.
Kim Smith, sorry.
All right, turn that heat on to
Kim Smith, no, you're right. Kim Smith?
I'm Kim Smith. I will be on this committee if we can make a committee of five, because I've led committees like this before, and if you don't have a horse car behind you, putting it on one man is not appropriate. We need to have at least five, so that we've got alternates and things that need to be done.
Okay, did you hear that? Committee of five is what Tim is proposing. I agree with that personally, although I'm not in the matter. What's your name?
Wayne Schrock.
Wayne, I can't nominate you, but I'd like to. Anybody want to nominate Wayne?
We know him better.
We know him better, he says.
How do you spell your last name?
S-C-H-R-O-C-K.
R-O-C-K? We have other nominations in the room. Yeah. Travis Williams.
How about Louis? Did he get in on
there? Okay. You know, I found Robert Smith.
We have six. We have five. They have six right now.
Six.
But we can have a committee of six or seven.
Melanie Molt. M-O-L-T.
Do you have a question?
Harmon?
If the federal government or government has ever disregarded, absolutely. I mean, the King's government, they completely, illegitimized anything that the colonies did. But you'd probably be able to answer that.
Since they didn't go through the colonies.
Yeah.
Yes. Because nobody can hear. They're not talking around it.
The key there is that they, and I'm going to tell you what they're going to say right now. They're going to say, we're the representatives of the people. They elected us to represent them. And so, whatever else is going on here is not legitimate because we're the representatives of the people. But see, that's why it's so important to understand not only this document, but your state constitution and your county formation documents. Because as soon as any form of government steps outside of your documents, what these are, what the constitution is, it's a chain, it's on the government. It's not something the government did for you. It's what you told the government you're allowed to do. And when the government steps outside of the constitution, it is no longer acting as your government. That's a key to understand. So, no, they're not going to like us. But the question then becomes,
they don't like anything but their own power. And are we to continue to empower them when they have their own self-interest and the interest that their structure is mine, and not the security, safety, and happiness of people?
What can you do since they're already convicted?
Since they're already convicted, one of the Committee of Safety, acting as an executive for the county, can put forward motions. One of those motions that we would recommend is that the same petition that's been made for forming an evidentiary review board to look at the entire case, using the supreme law of the land as our guide and comparing all the facts against it, decide whether or not the Hammonds are actually guilty of terrorism as they've been found. And another thing that bouncing it off of here is going to provide is the question that Hammond brought up, which is, do they have jurisdiction to impose this authority in the first place? So the Committee of Safety is literally, it's you guys asking all these questions. So that evidentiary review board is very important. We're going to, you, the people of Harney County, are going to decide whether or not this entity, which has its base 2,500 miles from here, ever had the authority to come and arrest and imprison and try and convict and further imprison the Hammonds in the first place. The second part of that is, the Committee of Safety, as the executive, can call forth people to defend this county from any foreign incursion. So, if you can empower yourselves in order to defend against any retribution which is taken against yourselves or for the Hammonds preliminarily. And what that means is to provide a sanctuary for the Hammonds so that they're not going to be molested. Provide a sanctuary for the Hammonds and for yourselves as you go about this process of an evidentiary review board and deciding to free yourselves.
I'm glad you said it. I am too. But there's plenty that can be done. And we don't have time to talk about it all here. We've been here for a part. But there is a tremendous amount that can be done for the Hammond. But at the beginning of that is getting the jurisdiction issue right. But there is a tremendous amount. Anyway, I just wanted to reaffirm that there is a tremendous amount that can be done for the Hammond. And all of us will benefit from it. Yes.
Yeah. In order to accept the case, I would like to request, if we're on this committee, that we provide an outline of our next steps and our next organizational activity. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. If somebody knows how to get this thing started and get going, put it on paper, get it to us, and we'll, and a list of the people who were nominated, and we'll take it from there and see what we can get done. But we need an outline, a guideline to start from, so that we don't fumble around for the next 6 months.
Absolutely. So that the process that we can go about very quickly to do that is an affirmation of these individuals who have been nominated, and then those individuals can get together and decide what the a convenient and prudent time for them to reconvene is going to be, at which time they can decide how to pursue things.
So with that, we need to vote, and it's been proposed, and if we disagree, that we put a committee of 7 people together. We have 7 nominees. We need to vote on each of those to see if the people are willing to have them on this committee. And so I would like to propose Kevin Johnson. All those in favor of Kevin Johnson being on the committee, please raise your hand. Any opposed? Okay, Kevin Johnson. Chris Riles. 4. Any opposed? Rick?
How do you say it again?
Hobine.
Hobine, I'm sorry.
Rick Hobine. All four? Any opposed? Tim Smith? All four? Any opposed? Wayne Schrock?
Schrock.
Wayne Schrock? All four? Any against? Travis Williams? All four? Any opposed?
He raised his own hand in opposition.
That was for fun, right?
That's when you know you're doing your duty.
Melanie Mort.
Molt.
That's an L. I can't even read my own writing.
Melody.
Very good. I have a mother-in-law named Melody. I won't forget again. Melody Molt. All four? Any opposed? It is unanimous. Is there any other matters that we need to bring before this body? The camera, Ken Taylor asked that if he had permission to sweep this room, if you're comfortable for that. Any opposed? Okay, Ken.
Thank you.
I want to bring up at this point that this is a huge step, obviously. It's not a comfortable position, and in line with your question from earlier, in the past, the Committee of Safety has conducted itself. Obviously, the members of that executive conducted their business in private, and they try to be as transparent as possible. There shouldn't be any secrecy if they're secure. And they may have to conduct, they're going to be conducting their business in private, and we are, as the people of Harney County here, are putting our trust in them that they're going to decide wisely. Yes, sir.
How will you provide the information that you're going to put together for us? Who will you give it to, and how will we get it?
Well, there is, you as a committee will need to unite, decide when you're going to meet, and make an agenda of your next meeting. There is tremendous amount of support and material that will be provided to you. We have organizations such as what Ryan is part of. I don't know if you guys are familiar with CALS, which is Coalition of Western States. It's a organization of representatives across the Western United States. They are very informed about these committees and what to do. And they anyway, you will get the support. We will offer it to you, and you can choose in which method you want to be trained and understand what your duties are to do. But it is there, and the material is there, and it is well organized.
There's entire volumes of books written about committees of safety, and there are entire volumes of documentation from the committees of safety themselves about from the period from the colonial era all the way up to the Civil War. So there's a wealth of information out there, and we can help you through that process.
I've already had representative from Washington who is very, he's an attorney, a constitutional attorney, and he has offered his services to me already, Ryan and his organization. So the training is there. It has been brought to my attention that we need to show by voice so it is recorded that we did assemble a committee of safety here. So I propose, again, we need to do this by yeas and nays so we have it recorded. Melody Molt, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say nay. It is unanimous.
Hammond, read through that one more time.
Boy, I don't know if I could do it.
Sorry, but the camera didn't just fire up till just now. So.
I understand it. It's
Stand up.
Okay, Kevin Johnson.
Kevin Johnson. Or come forward so we can know.
That's fine, just stand. Kevin Johnson.
Kevin Johnson.
Chris Ryle.
Chris Ryle.
Rick.
Havine.
Rick Havine.
Kim Smith.
Kim Smith.
Wayne Schrock.
Schrock.
Travis Williams.
He is a Schrock.
Travis Williams.
And Melody Mole. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Say nay. It is unanimous. Thank you.
Critical moment.
I guess we convene this meeting and bring some more coffee. Thank you.
Waiting for someone to tell me it's my turn.